Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see, I have the wonderful Leonard Brown with me today. So how are you, Leonard? Are you coping well?
I'm very well, thanks, Graeme. Thanks for inviting me on.
Good stuff. How are you coping through this lockdown nonsense? Are you surviving?
Yeah, just about. It's been very tough, I think, for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And I think it's all in the mind that you have to keep yourself going.
Yes.
It's pretty tough to get through, but hopefully by the end of this year we'll be seeing the sunlight and we'll hopefully get back to playing again fully next year.
Yeah, that would be good, just to feel the breath of an audience. It's just and safely as well, obviously. But yeah, I think we're all definitely missing that, and I'm sure the audiences are missing yourself as well, because you've got a very eclectic repertoire, and it pleases an awful lot of people. So there'd be a lot of people missing it.
I try to play everything. That's how I was brought up, and to try and play all sorts of different styles and try to appeal to the biggest market possible.
Yep, well, that's important. That's important. In fact, what we'll do is we'll play a video just now, and then we can have a wee blether after that, just to give people an idea of what we're talking about. Let's play your ABBA medley.
Okay.
This is the ABBA medley. One, two, three, four. Duncan Finley. We'll be right back.
So that was fabulous. I mean, that there's some effort went into that arrangement.
Yeah. Oh, it's like I always thought that ABBA music appeals to everyone of all ages. So when I started doing the theatre shows, I tried to pick material that would suit just such a broad range of people.
It certainly does that, and it's you know, like I say, the arrangement as well for like the medley going from one into the other as well. It was very well done, and the video is beautiful quality as well. I mean, I take it you had a company doing that for you, or what's
yeah, I had a company do that, and a great job they did.
Yeah.
And that was made into the live DVD
okay.
that we did.
Okay.
So that was fantastic.
Still available, yeah?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Cool. Well, people can go to your website for that.
Yeah.
So what's your website?
www.leonardbrownaccordion.co.uk.
Okay, that's right. Well, I'll have that in the video description so people can click on the link if it makes it easier for them to find it as well. So I think we need to know more about Leonard Brown. So what age did you start playing? Tell me a bit more about your history.
So I started playing when I was 4 years old on piano.
Okay.
And actually I've got an interesting story to tell. All during the lockdown, I was thinking about how I started off, and I remember my first ever piano teacher, a guy called Norman Brown from County Durham, and I remember I had 9 great years with him,
mm-hmm.
got through quite a lot of grades and stuff, and all through this lockdown I've been thinking about him and wondering if he was still around, and so it was probably about a month ago I started working for Uber Eats delivery.
All right.
And I was in that area where he lived, and I still remembered the house number and where he lived, and what I did was I knocked on the door, and I was going to give him a CD, the latest one, and when I got there, knocked on the door, and his wife answered, and I says, is it Norman and Glynis? And she unfortunately passed away just before the lockdown last year, so it was kind of sad, but it was poignant that I'd been thinking about him all through the lockdown, and
yeah.
not knowing that he'd passed on.
Okay.
So he really is the reason that I became so proficient early on, and every year he used to do a video at Christmas time, and I used to play all of the Christmas songs, and he used to video it, and we used to get a copy
mm-hmm.
To watch with the family. So it was always good to see the progress from each year. So yeah, I started on at 4 years old. Then I went started Irish dancing when I was 7.
Okay.
I got bored one Friday night, wanted to know what was down at the local hall, walked in, and it was an Irish dance class, and I just fell in love with the music, Irish accordion music to start with, and the first accordion player I ever heard play was Seamus O'Sullivan.
Okay.
So that was back when I was 7, and I did 3 years of Irish dancing with the McElvogue School of Dancing in South Shields, and I got 121 medals and 17 trophies.
My goodness, must be all right then.
So I did not too bad, but when I got to 11, I went into the senior school, and the word got out that I was an Irish dancer, and I got bullied quite a bit for that. And it was a decision I made at that point to then stop doing the dancing and then take up the accordion.
Okay.
Which I have to thank the bullies, really, because if I hadn't have stopped dancing, then I wouldn't have taken up the accordion. So it's all about making the best out of a bad situation.
Absolutely.
And, so I went on from there, and I was self-taught really on the accordion. I went to a few beginner lessons at the start for the left hand, but that was it. And then just went on from there, started listening to CDs and various artists that I would come across.
Nice. Okay, very good. And yes, I mean, it's obviously you did something right by the time you know got to the stage you're at. If you were self-taught, it's pretty good going, and it's I'm self-taught myself, so it's kind of, I know the journey you need to take for that, but it's you know, it's no mean feat. And I was the same. I had a few lessons from my left hand, but that was it. But that's yeah, it's remarkable. It's good to have that journey. And I mean, I know you from, you know, from the festivals and stuff and competing, you know, back in the day when we were young lads.
What do you mean, when we were?
Sorry, when were we? Are we still young lads? Are we just still qualifying for that?
Well, I know I am.
I thought you're a bit younger than me, right enough. But very good. That's fabulous, though. It's nice to have that story behind you and stuff as well. So, you went on to study music, didn't you?
I did, yeah. So after doing a few years of college, I went to Newcastle University. I studied a Bachelor of Arts in Classical Music, but luckily I was allowed to transition the accordion in with the classical course in the second year. Okay. Did classical first year, then I had the great teaching of Ian Lothian.
Okay.
And he brought some new stuff to the table which I didn't know about, and he was a great guy to listen to and work with. And then in the final year I did my final recital, and it was myself and Malcolm. I asked Malcolm to come down and play alongside us, and we ended up getting one of the very highest marks ever given for a recital, which we just couldn't believe. I mean, Malcolm still raves about it, and he's got the sheet with the comments on it, you know, and he's kept that for you know, his own purpose. But just a fabulous feeling to take an accordion into a recital and come up with a really, really high mark.
That's fabulous. Yeah, because it's no mean feat. I mean, the accordion is you know, a coordination marvel. You know, for most players that find it, you know, natural, there's a million people that find it completely unnatural to be doing what you're doing. And everything else as well. So it's to non-players, it can be, you know, pretty impressive what we're doing, because there's a lot of work goes into it, and you probably well deserved, you know, the mark anyway for your ability and stuff. So well done, it's good.
Yeah, I think you're dead right about non-musicians who appreciate what we're doing. Mm-hmm. Because I think as musicians we sometimes don't realise the extent of where we're at. And I don't think we realise what we're doing. Mm-hmm. Because we've done it. It's just natural for us to do, you know. But it would be the same for the likes of us looking at a heart surgeon performing an operation, and we're going, this is unbelievable.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
You know, it's that sort of scale. If it just blows your mind, you know.
Yep. Absolutely. Okay, well, it's probably time for another tune from you. So this time we've got the four-string polka with Maggie Adamson. So let's put that on, and we're going to have a play thereafter. Here we go. Thank you. Very cool indeed. I like that. That was good fun. Maggie's a smashing player as well.
Brilliant, yeah.
Yeah, very good. Very good indeed. So where was that? Where did you record that? It's a nice place.
That was the Athol Palace in Pitlochry.
Nice.
And it was recorded by the audio was recorded at SC Recordings at Bridge of Erne, Stephen Cargary.
Mm-hmm.
We did six albums at Stephen's, fantastic recordings. And it was filmed by Red Barn Studios, who incidentally a couple of weeks ago got in touch to say that they had found 100 of my DVDs.
So they did,
and
yeah.
They wanted to know if I wanted to take them off them, and I said, well, really, I don't think I'll be able to sell them, you know. I think it's just, you know, everyone who wants one's got one, if you like. And
yeah.
And I just said, you know, instead of them just going into the shop in the sky, would it not be nice if you sent them down? I would send them out to 100 care homes, you know. And the response was just amazing.
Yeah, that was a great idea. And hopefully all those care homes will enjoy them and benefit greatly from them, I'm sure.
Yeah, I hope so. Anyway, as I say, it was just to, you know, you get these ideas that pop into your head, and that just when I heard it, I just thought, oh, that would be really good, you know, because I mean, it's only the cost of the postage that's ended up being the outlay, you know. So just thank you to those who put the nominations in, and that they're all away, and I'm already starting to get a few emails back saying thank you very much for the kind donation, and so it's good.
Yeah,
it's nice
fabulous.
To give something back.
Lovely gesture, and like I said, I'm pretty sure they will watch it many times. Whoever's got them, so that's fabulous news. Good stuff. And you play with Malcolm an awful lot as well. Malcolm Ross is a very wonderful chap as well, a very good drummer. You just played with him your whole life, or how's that gone?
Well, I would say. I met him in 2009 at Rothbury Accordion Club, and it was Stephen Cartery who was playing that night.
Okay.
And I'd already heard Malcolm on one of Wayne Robertson's recordings, and Wayne was one of my heroes growing up. And I knew then that was the person that I wanted to sort of form a duo if I was going to do accordion and fiddle clubs.
Mm-hmm.
So we ended up having my first booking on the 15th of November 2010 at Dunn's Accordion Club.
Good
so
memory.
We've been going. I've got a great memory for dates and everything. Yeah. You know, just the way it goes. But I started with Malcolm there, and we've been doing the accordion club and dance circuit for, well, it'll be coming up 11 years in November. Well, if you take 1 year off for not playing, that's 10 years, you know, in total. So, and in that time we've won two Guest Artists of the Year awards.
Fabulous.
And we've won, as a band, we've won two CD of the Year awards as well. So,
excellent stuff. Oh, that's amazing. No, it's good. Obviously you're putting the work in, but you're very popular, and you know you deserve all the glory for it as well. So the awards, I'm sure, are you know very deserved as well. So well done. Congratulations.
Well, it's a bit like yourself, you know, you're putting all the effort in to entertain everybody, and as with others are, but you know, it's a sense of dedication to be able to come on nearly every night and perform, you know. I know personally that it's very, very difficult to get yourself motivated when you're sitting behind a screen, and that's why I think it's marvellous that what you can do. You've got the equipment, you've got the setup, it looks fantastic, and I think you'll be reaping the rewards from people who are just utterly delighted that, you know, music's available.
Yeah, just knowing there's people there that are enjoying it, that's the important part, just keeping people entertained, and as we would do in normal times, you know. It's to me, it doesn't, I mean, it's the having the right equipment, that is my reward at the moment, or reward, because you know, it's through their support we've managed to get, you know, to upgrade things a wee bit and make sure that everything's reliable. Because that was the hardest part of the whole year, is just making sure that you had the right equipment, and we're all just relying on that cable carrying the internet signal. You know, even now, so it's there's a lot riding on making sure that everything works, but it's kind of, I've got a wee bit of a technical mind when it comes to these things. I do quite enjoy it and get a wee kick out of it when it all works first time, which hasn't always been the case, but it's good, it's working well now, so I'm really pleased. And we've got a wonderful wee studio here, and hopefully when people are allowed to travel around and do things, then we can have more than just me sitting playing in the corner. We can have guests, and there's actually space here for maybe a small audience between 5 and 10 people as well, so we could have a little wee music venue here. So fingers crossed that will happen, be able to happen in the not too distant future. But until then, I'll just keep playing to my camera.
That's it.
There's not much else I can do. Right, I've got one more video to put on, and we'll play that just now. This is a fabulous Glenn Miller medley. What made you do a Glenn Miller medley?
I just think that was a style of music that was popular with my audience, and obviously I take great pride in picking the right music, so I wanted to try and especially for the theatre shows, you know, that it's much more than just an accordion club or a concert. It's a show, and it has to have a meaning to it, and a start, middle, and end.
Absolutely.
And I just feel that you know, the stuff like Glenn Miller medley and the Andre Rieu stuff, and that just appeals to a bigger audience, and that's why I came up with those medleys, you know.
Good stuff. Right, well, let's stick it on, see how it goes. Here we go.
This is a Glenn Miller medley.
Oh yeah, that's fabulous.
This is a Glenn Miller.
Oh, it's away again. Hang on 2 seconds, I'll stop that. So yeah, absolutely fabulous. Well done. And it's, you know, you could, I mean, even just sitting watching that, the smile on my face, you know, when it started playing, it's just, it just ticks all the right boxes, doesn't it?
You want to see your face when it finished?
No, but, absolutely fabulous. Well done.
I don't know if you noticed the red suit there, but I was a hell of a size then, and I went on a big diet and I lost 3.5 stone.
Okay, well done.
In the middle of 2019, and actually, obviously, the red suit didn't fit anymore, so it was that big that I managed to get a pair of curtains out of it. So.
Oh well, I got a shirt as well.
Yeah.
Well done. Oh, fabulous. Yeah, no, well done with the I mean, even standing with a goalie on your wrapped around your shoulders, going through all that, you know, wearing a suit, it's that's no mean feat as well. So it's a good workout.
Yeah, but it's always it was normally the kilt in the first half, and then the suit in the second half. And as you say, especially the size I was there, the sweat just pours off you. And it really is. I mean, it's a total workout playing, and you know, a 3-hour show, and you're maybe on maybe 1 hour and 20 minutes or 1 hour and 30 out of that 3 hours, and you just, you know, it is a big workout.
Yeah, but no, it's I mean, it's brilliant that you know you've always managed to get to generate good ticket sales and everything else as well to be able to do these concerts and stuff. I was never brave enough to do my own concert in that sort of scenario, because I'm always frightened that no one will come. No, you've always been really good at taking those kind of ventures and would say risk, but you're pretty good at selling the tickets. But and yeah. Entrepreneurial side of your brain works really well.
Yeah, well, the thing was for me. I had a feeling that the way it was going to go, people weren't going to just continue phoning me, you know. I had to actually go and look for work myself. Absolutely. And I just felt that it was the right time in certainly my life that I'd done the groundwork, because that's what you've got to do. You've got to do the groundwork when you're young. Mm-hmm. And I started doing accordion clubs when I was 17, and after about 4 or 5 years, you know, you get a thirst for doing something different, and yep. That's the reason why I took it upon myself to do these sort of shows. I did one at Rothbury in the hall, and I think the capacity is about 150, and we had 220 people the first concert I ever did.
Yeah.
Because I was that worried about not selling the tickets that I oversold.
Okay.
And if you know what I mean. Yeah. Without realizing. Mm-hmm. The first venture, you wanted to go well. Mm-hmm. And you know, I had loads of things up my sleeve. I had a coach with my family on.
Yeah.
And I stopped all off at all these different places to pick folk up, and there was about 50 people on a coach that came, and then the lady from Rothbury, Anne Brown, and Maxine Cummings, they also helped to sell tickets locally in their locality. Yeah. And I think they got a bit mulled up with their figures, how many they'd actually sold. So when they told me, you know, I was adding it up and saying, I'm about 50 short here. Mm-hmm. And then as the night went on, I mean, we still had people coming in through the door on the night, you know.
Yeah.
They were actually going into the side room, and the original plan was to have tables, but we had to just get rid of the tables and just have all seating. It was an incredible to have the 6-piece band. I had Davey Stewart, I had Maggie, I had Liam, John, and I had Malcolm and myself, and we had a host of guests as well. And it was just incredible to see a place like that jumping.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they were dancing up and down the aisles, because it wasn't just your normal accordion and fiddle club folk who would sit and be respectful, listening to each note.
Yep.
And the phrase and everything. It was people who wanted a great time, and they were just up dancing. I mean, we had the Orange Blossom Special, they were going round and round. And at the time, one of the big chart hits was Get Lucky, at the tune. And we did an arrangement of that, and it was just, people were just dancing up and down. There was just, I always remember that as the first one I ever did, and then I just got a thirst for doing that, and you know, ever since, I mean, that's maybe 6 years, 7 years now, been doing a hell of a lot of concerts and shows, and
good.
It's just built up, you know.
Yeah.
But when you say risk, that there's a huge risk involved, and I found that out no more than when the pandemic hit. I was meant to do a dance weekend at Tynemouth, just the weekend where the lockdown happened.
Yeah.
And it was all sold out, the playhouse, everything. And, you know, the financial loss that you get from that has just been, you know, it's really hard hitting. So you do get the rewards, but you also get hit if it goes the wrong way. And that's why I'm always going to be a little bit wary next time of doing these things in the current, you know.
Yeah, it's going to be quite hard to ensure these events now as well going forward, with whether they go ahead or not. So that's why there's so many more events this year getting cancelled, because the investors just don't have the confidence that either it's going to go ahead, or be if they'll get, you know, any insurance if it does get cancelled. So it's kind
of, I've cancelled everything for this year.
Yeah.
The only thing I've got is basically anybody who's booked me and who's transferred a date over.
Yeah.
That's all I'll be doing this year.
Yeah,
and then hopefully looking into the new year, we'll try and build on something. But it is going to take a long time. It's just about getting people out, and once you've seen one person do something, it'll have an effect, you know.
Yeah.
And I do think it will pick up very quickly, but once that threshold has been set and we've passed it, you know, I mean, they're doing a hell of a great job on the vaccinations, and you know, it's just, I don't want to be the one that you get the, everyone gets their vaccinations, but you know, young folk like us, if I can and by the time I get to do the gig, everybody's been vaccinated but me, and I kind of go,
yeah,
you know,
this is it, that's the thing. We're going to be, we're definitely going to be one of the last age groups to get seen to, but I'd rather everyone else got theirs, and I can wait. I'm healthy and young, as you say, so we're not in a, you know, it'll happen when it happens, but I also don't want to be the guy responsible for everyone getting locked down again by running events too early, and it being a bit irresponsible. So we'll see how things go, but yeah, as you were saying, I'm not really taking on anything majorly new this year, just as you say, the transferred dates as well, so hopefully some of them might go ahead, but a lot of them are jumping ship now to next year as well. So
yeah, you just don't know, and it's I've stopped putting a time limit on it, because when I cancelled or postponed Tynemouth, I postponed it until this September, which was 18 months, and I thought, you know, I was giving it a really long time to get sorted, and I've ended up just cancelling it altogether, and you know, I think it's the right thing to do, because you start afresh then, you know, and it's just, it's very, very sad, because a lot of work goes into these things, and you're just saying goodbye to it, basically, you know. And
and just parking it, put it in the cupboard, and open it up when it's, you know, things will be. I've got a lot of projects just on ice, you know, and they're there when we're allowed to use them, and when that happens, then it'll be grand. But it's it's tricky, isn't it? But
yeah,
what we're gonna do. Anyway, on that note, I think we should call it a day. Thank you very much, Leonard, for joining me today for the Cayley Cabin Blethers. I wish you all the best for the rest of the lockdown, and hopefully it won't be too long before we can get some more of those events on the go, and maybe we can do something, a wee joint venture not too far away.
Well, that would be great, Graeme, and thanks very much for inviting us on to your show. All the best with it. You're doing a great service to everybody. I just wish I had your temperament to, with all of the technological side of things, but more power to elbow, and we will see you in person, I'm sure, sometime.
Excellent. Cheers, Leonard. Thank you very much. We'll see you soon.
All the best. Thanks, everyone.
Bye.